Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of The Rocky Mountain Moving Picture Association by Loren D. Estleman. Narrated by George Guidall. This work is copyrighted 1999 by Loren D. Estleman. This recording is copyrighted 2000 by Recorded Books Incorporated. Hollywood, 1913. In the dusty desert community of Los Angeles, a ragtag film company cranks out silent movies in defiance of the law. Young Dmitri Pulski works for his father's ice company in the snowy Sierra Nevadas, and when an astonishing order for 10 tons of ice by something called the Rocky Mountain Moving Picture Association is received, he is sent on a journey south to investigate. Almost immediately, Dmitri finds himself caught up in the world of the Wild West's last boomtown, where the big guns are named D.W. Griffith, Tom Mix, and Lillian Gish, and men and women scramble for the money to be made with Thomas Edison's amazing little box. And now, the Rocky Mountain Moving Picture Association.
1926. A death in season. Buck would have loved it. The throngs in fedoras, straw boaters, and cloches, compressed into squares by Jimmy Walker's finest, the best cops money could buy, in their shining rubber ponchos and cap shields. The ropes and barricades, erected to funnel the mourners from four abreast to two, forming a line 11 blocks long. The rain sizzling off the awning of Frank E. Campbell's funeral chapel and making the sea of black umbrellas glisten. That last was a bit of cooperation from the weather Buck had never managed to achieve, which was why he refused to make up a shooting schedule, preferring to hold off the cemetery procession until the rain decided to fall. Plugging in the desert chase when the sun insisted on shining, Buck, who never believed in chance, good fortune, would have scanned the rooftops looking for men with hoses. Airborne cloud seeders weren't out of the question, provided Adolf Zukor agreed to a quid pro quo with George M. Cohan in return for permission to rain on Broadway. No one understood the territorial imperative better than an old pirate. He shook his head, missing Buck, and handed $5 to a fellow who had stood in line 2 hours for the express purpose of selling his position. He was in no great personal hurry, but the price would only go up, and he'd heard a rumor that Harry Klemfuss would soon seal the casket to prevent the taking of souvenirs. It was the kind of rumor that could spark another riot. The mounted patrolmen were already in place, prepared to charge. And in any case, he hadn't come all this way and stood in the rain all this time to look at a silver bronze box. Klemfuss didn't care who took souvenirs. Another riot would actually help ensure the box office for the two unreleased films in the can. Hell, Hollywood would say, Harry will do anything to get you ink, even after you're dead. Buck and Klemfuss would have gotten along, until their interests conflicted. The crowd was orderly. Not like earlier in the day when gangs of young women armed with umbrellas had laid siege to the entrance and had to be beaten back with billy clubs. Many wore black veils and armbands, although here and there he spotted a fancy boy in droopy balloon pants and a sodden bolero vest. Even at the height of the pink powder puff controversy, the press had ignored the man's vast homosexual following. The woman to his right, a plump chatterbox clutching a framed studio print to her breasts, said she had seen a sainted devil 17 times. Her makeup was streaming, but he suspected it was more from the rain than from tears. She was as animated as if she were on her way to a personal appearance. Inside the entrance, he stood aside to let the woman start up the stairs ahead of him. The deep red runner was striped down the center with brown mud tracked in from the street. From here on, it was step up, wait, step up, wait. The wait was seldom longer than a second. He'd heard that a woman who had fainted from anxiety and the August heat had been allowed a 3-second visitation to compensate her for her ordeal. He was on the landing now, close enough to see through the open door into the small room where the body lay in state. where it had been moved from the larger and more prestigious gold room after the ornaments and fixtures had been sacked by rioters. He saw the tall candles, the marble statuary, the wall of ferns behind the bier. He couldn't see the casket or its occupant for the Hollywood fascisti surrounding it. Another Klemfuss coup, although Mussolini had sent a cable denying ownership of these particular black shirts, or of an ostentatious wreath bearing the legend "From Benito." Hellinger and Winchell were back in their offices banging black box Remingtons to commemorate the spectacle, and of course Jimmy, the night mayor of New York, had had words to say. Grogan of the Evening Graphic had faked up a cadaver shot before the genuine corpse had even arrived at the parlor and composited a cordial meeting with Caruso in the afterlife. No confirmation yet that Capone men would board the funeral train in Chicago to accompany the body across the continent with Tommy guns in their laps. That one had Runyon all over it. Anyway, it was a woman's event. Pola Negri, they said, had paid her respects in $3,000 widow's weeds with the help of an army airmail plane to whisk her there from the West Coast. Ziegfeld beauty Marion K. Brenda, a Floridora in search of a surname, had taken umbrage, claiming that she, not the Polish actress, had been the deceased's future intended. Mary Pickford was expected to show up at the services later at St. Malachy's. No suicides there, that was reserved for those who didn't know him. In London, an Apache dancer had poisoned herself. In New York, a housewife had swallowed iodine and shot herself twice, sprawling poetically on a pile of 8x10 glossies. In Santa Monica, a woman had put on her wedding dress and walked into the ocean. But that was California. He wondered if any of them thought they had a better chance of meeting the object of their passion in a crowded heaven than they'd had on Earth. He was in the room now. The air smelled woozily of flowers, thousands of flowers, sent from as far away as Bolshevik Russia, bouquets and baskets and pots and gondolas of roses, carnations, hibiscus, peonies, buttercups, tulips, lady slippers, lilies, poppies, geraniums, chrysanthemums, primrose, orchids, bluebells, African violets, all the obnoxious and dazzling bounty of a death in season. The room had not been sufficient to contain them, and they had been spread out throughout both floors. Farther in the aftermath of olfactory overload, he noticed the more prosaic odors of melted wax, rubber galoshes, and wet wool. These smells reminded him of a field trip to a museum. He took his turn at the bookstand, where he was forced to wait while yet another guest book was borne away, heavy with the weight of its signatures, and its replacement brought. The spine cracked when it was opened by a young attendant in a black cutaway and white cotton gloves. He accepted the feather quill and, without thinking, signed a name he hadn't used in 10 years. He'd been ruminating too deeply on the past. He made no attempt to correct the mistake, but surrendered the quill and shuffled forward with the line, his hat now in his hand. Now he heard sobbing. Genuine, probably, Klemfuss's hired female mourners having wept their bit shortly after the doors opened. A whispered snatch of the 23rd Psalm, the toneless chant of the black shirt's selected spokesman to keep it moving, keep it moving. And now he was at the opening in the ropes. And now he was there, before the casket. They had him propped against a white satin pillow in a black tuxedo with extravagant lapels and a silk bow tie under a dome of shatterproof glass. So much for souvenir hunting. They'd wound a rosary around his folded hands, the white fingers with their waxy nails, and turned his head 3/4 so he could share a slight conspiratorial smile with his visitors, amused by the ludicrous turnout, far better than any of his premieres, especially the most recent. Peritonitis. It seemed a drastic thing to have to do to win back one's audience. Jerry Jarrett would have found a way to fake it. He looked down at the marble-white features, the obvious paint. Where was the powder puff now? There was the lacquered black hair, no gray in it, or dye, as why should there be at 31, showing the marks of the comb-like grooves in a new record? There were the razored sideburns, the dimpled upper lip, and long, swooping lashes. It couldn't be real. He looked too much like his movies. And then His second was over. He turned away, descended a homely set of stairs with a rubber runner, and passed out through a side door where he suspected the corpses entered, wrapped in rubber sheets and without music. Out into the snot-like rain, among the klaxons and electric signs and the stink of horseshit. The last, so reminiscent of a rocky chute. Putting on his hat, thinking, Rodolfo Alfonso Raffaello Pier Filibert Guglielmi di Valentina d'Antonguola. Great lover, mighty sheik, O immortal Valentino. In what unlabeled pauper's ditch would you be lying, had not Arthur Bensinger Jr. tripped over a bucket of washers in the Bensinger and Rausch Hardware and Electrical Supply of Union City in 1909. 1913. Chapter 1. The name came to him the way everything did that he trusted when he was reading Jack London. He had just opened the semi-monthly magazine of the San Francisco Call, the December 1, 1912 number containing the story The Captain of the Susan Drew. The provocative pen and ink illustration and the electrifying byline warmed him in a way the wood-burning stove at his elbow could not. But the lead paragraph might have been written in Balinese, for all he comprehended it. Suddenly he put aside the magazine, touched the blunt point of the whittled yellow pencil to his tongue, and wrote the name on the sheet of coarse paper he'd been using for his figures. He looked at it, holding the sheet out at arm's length, the way his father tried to read things when he'd misplaced his glasses, then put it down and copied out the legend again and again, now printing, now in cursive, uppercase, lowercase, upper and lower, stacking it down the sheet like a bride-to-be trying out her new name. He had to see it in type. He reached across the rickety work table, slid over the Blickensdörfer number 7 on its wooden pallet, good, loyal Blick, fellow veteran of 100,000 unpublished words, rolled another sheet into the platen, and pecked out the letters. "Who's Tom Boston?" He jumped. He'd been so engrossed he hadn't heard the door opening behind him or even felt the rush of razor-cold air that came in with Yuri. The big half-Tartar was wearing his bearskin coat and hat, and at a glance he appeared to be covered with coarse hair from his head to the tops of his lace-up boots. Only his Rasputin eyes and wind-chapped condor's beak of a nose showed between the long whiskers and thatched brows. His moist breath had frozen the hairs about his mouth into stalactites. He was staring at the sheet in the machine. "I am," said the young man, calmed now by the Ukrainian's presence, which was like a huge enveloping muffler. "If it works, does it work? What's wrong with the name your father gave you?" "Nothing, except that I was 10 years old before I could spell it. Would you buy a story from someone named Dmitri Andreevich Pulski?" "Why should I buy one? You read them to me all the time for free." "I mean, if you were an editor, Jack London got 160 rejections before he made his first sale. That's 12 less than me. I'm just as good a writer as he was when he started. It must be the name." "Why Tom Boston?" "It just came to me. Forget you've known me as Dmitri all my life. How does it sound?" "I guess it's okay. I don't read anything but signs. If I was to start, it wouldn't be because of a name." "Not everyone's like you." He looked at the sheet. "Tom Boston." It was the first time he'd said it aloud. He tore out the sheet, folded it, and put it in the breast pocket of his heavy woolen shirt. It would be a valuable artifact. Then he lifted the typewriter's cover from the plank floor and snapped and latched it into place. The curved wooden case looked like it belonged to a sewing machine. "Anything wrong? I just came in to tell you we're ready to start cutting. I'll be out in a minute." When Yuri left, the young man put on his mackinaw and fleece-lined cap, buckling the strap under his chin so his ears would stay covered, and found his mittens. He gave himself the indulgence of an affectionate look around before he turned out the lantern. The 6x8 shack, built of corrugated iron with a tar-paper lining, was the only private place he knew. Although it was intended for the workers to escape the weather and warm up over coffee, they seldom entered it when he was inside. Everyone who worked for the Sierra Nevada Ice Company knew that the owner's son was going to be a great writer, like Pushkin, and that writers required privacy the way ice cutters needed strong backs and vodka. Guilt for his selfish acceptance of this favor kept him from personalizing the shack beyond the occasional copy of Century and the Overland Monthly and a picture of Jack London using a boulder for a desk, clipped from Cosmopolitan and tacked to the wall above the work table. He did most of his writing and reading there and stuffed his manuscripts into brown 10x12 envelopes for mailing. He thought of the place as his study, but never referred to it as anything but the shack. He remembered to smear lampblack under his eyes before stepping outside, and he was glad he had. Although Yuri and his crew had thoroughly planed the snow from the lake's surface, the ice beneath remained white enough to dazzle in the bright sun, and if one failed to take precautions against the glare, to blind. To the east, Mount Shasta below its frozen peak was the precise deep blue of the sky and might have broken away from it in a jagged shard, as if the sky were a pane of glass and something had struck it from the other side. As he watched, a wind, 14,000 feet up, skinned a slice of dry snow from the peak and scrolled it outward like smoke. The curl would measure a mile. It confounded all his senses to think that that distant puff was a dozen times more powerful than the gust that now came at him from the opposite direction, pushing a solid volume of air that boxed his ears and shook the side of the shack, making tinny thunder. He turned his back to keep the ice crystals from cutting his face. It was just the kind of scene he labored hours over the blick, trying to get right and hadn't yet, not to his own satisfaction. But he would. Once the lake was cleared of snow, activity had continued with all haste before it drifted back. The ice plow, built heavily of elm and cast iron, required a 6-horse team to pull it. The driver, an elderly Cossack named Esol, labored to haul himself into the iron seat and groped for the lines, at which point the years fell away like the halves of a dried pod. With a series of barks and whistles through his remaining teeth, he coaxed the brutes forward, cutting twin furrows as straight as piano wire from east to west. At the end, he turned the team and repeated the procedure from west to east. And when the entire lake had been scored in this way, he drove to the north shore and began cutting from north to south, carving the surface neatly into 3-foot squares. Then the sawyers moved in. This was where Dmitri took his turn. As the son of the owner, he was there to oversee the operation, but as he began to spend more and more time while on site in the shack, reading and typing, Yuri had assumed most of his responsibilities as foreman. The young man insisted on carrying his weight, however, and had surprised and impressed the others by selecting the most arduous of all the chores involved in harvesting ice. The work commenced with chipping a hole in one corner of the first square with a pick or chisel. When an opening had been created that was large enough to insert the end of a long, square-toothed saw blade, the cutting began in earnest, each man sawing along the lines scored by the plow. Showers of ice shavings like sawdust stung faces and made eyes water. Once a brisk rhythm was established, the friction did much of the work, slicing through the ice like a heated knife through lard. But on bitter days when temperatures neared zero, as they did today, merely pausing for breath allowed the ice to refreeze around the blade, locking it in place. A series of huffing, two-handed lunges was then required to break it free. Very soon, Dmitri was sweating in spite of the cold. He paused after cutting his third block to strip off his coat and mittens. At the end of a section, he and the others traded saws for crowbars and cant dogs, prying loose the section and heaving it aside with the hooks, hinged like the jaws of a mastiff, to form a canal of open black water. Men then moved in with poles and pushed the floating cakes along the canal or heaved them up onto the uncut ice and slewed them to shore, where the rest of the crew waited with cant dogs to hoist them onto chain-driven belts operated by hand cranks. The cranks were seized and turned. The chains clankety-clanked, caught up the slack, and carried the great silver-blue blocks up to the ice house on the hill, where they plunged through a loft-like opening onto a plank floor covered with sawdust. As architecture, the storage building was considerably more substantial than the shack, which had been thrown together as an afterthought with sheets of corrugated roofing left over from the larger construction. It was as big as a warehouse, with triple walls built of native pine, the spaces between packed tightly with sawdust and wood shavings as insulation against the heat of summer, when the lake was open blue water and even the white cap of Shasta had dwindled to half its present size. By then, the great stack of ice would be nearly as valuable as bullion. The harvest complete, Dmitri climbed the slope to the shack, foundering a little in the deep drifts, as much from exhaustion as from the awkwardness of the footing. He carried his coat slung over one shoulder with the mittens in the pockets. His own sweat had begun to chill him beneath the flannel lining of his shirt. He hoped the ashes in the stove were still hot. He didn't look forward to starting a new fire from scratch, shivering in the dank interior cold. A puff of warm air surprised him when he opened the door. Then he realized the lantern was lit. His father was seated at the work table, holding the sheet Dmitri had been scribbling on earlier.
Who's Tom Boston?
Andrei Ivanovich Pulski was a compact man, small for a Russian, who looked more like a St. Petersburg haberdasher than a man who had spent most of his life laboring with his hands. He wore suits everywhere, even up here, where he had on heavy tweeds with the trousers neatly tucked into the tops of knee-high stovepipes. His overcoat, with its astrakhan collar and cuffs, hung over the back of the chair. He brushed his thick brown hair straight back and had his goatee trimmed by a barber twice a week. Dmitri hung up his Mackinaw and cap and went over to warm himself by the stove. The woodbox was nearly empty. All those years of cutting and carrying ice had left the elder Pulski with a chronic chill that even in summer forced him to lay a fire and spread a blanket over his knees when he studied the company ledgers in the evening. Dmitri had never seen him read a book or give more than passing attention to a newspaper. Just a character. He didn't want to get into it just then. I didn't see the Ford.
Your Uncle Paul dropped me off. He's in town picking up the mail. Is this what you do when I send you up here to work?
He brushed the sheet with his fingertips. I just finished cutting a ton of ice.
That's not your job.
I'm better at it than I am at giving orders. Half these men watched me grow up. They've seen me in knickers.
Then there shouldn't be any confusion about whose son you are.
He made no answer. His father was slow to anger, but once he began, there was nothing to do but wait until his passion had run its course. Andrei's own grandfather had cut ice in Alaska to fill the demand created by the gold rush. Then, when the demand subsided, had come to California to hunt sea otters for the Russian-American company. When the otters played out, San Francisco was still in need of ice, and so Andrei's father and a partner had formed the Sierra Nevada Ice Company to harvest the northern lakes. He was the grandson of a mountain man and trapper, the descendant of an officer in the Tsar's army, and stubborn traces of the career soldier and hardy pioneer remained beneath the executive exterior, like the tough Sierra grass under 2 feet of snow. He had spent his youth working side by side with his own father's employees until the business was sound. Now he took it as a personal affront, that his son should do the same, as if the years of toil had made no progress. Dmitri couldn't tell if his father was more upset by that or by his own ambition to be a writer instead of an iceman. Andrei surprised him for the second time that day by letting the matter drop along with the scratch sheet.
How much ice do we have in inventory?
The young man hesitated. About 8 tons, including today's.
I have received an order for all we have.
Who from, the city of San Francisco?
Some company in Los Angeles.
He pronounced it with a hard G, as did everyone Dmitri knew. Only the occasional Mexican who came up to work with them for a winter softened the consonant. As he said it, Andrei drew a folded sheet of paper from an inside breast pocket, snapped it open, and hooked on his gold-rimmed spectacles to look at it.
The Rocky Mountain Moving Picture Association. Have you heard of it?
He said he hadn't. Moving pictures. He'd seen 2 or 3 flicker shows at the end of the vaudeville bill at the Opera House in San Francisco. Crude, jerky images of firefighters in action and young women undressing. But it had never occurred to him that anyone made a living making and showing the things.
We don't sell that much by August, Dmitri said. It's only January. See for yourself.
Dmitri accepted the sheet and turned it toward the lantern. The name his father had read was professionally printed across the top, along with an address on Yucca Avenue. Dear Sir, an exhaustive survey
conducted among suppliers of ice throughout the Pacific Northwest has led us to the conclusion that the Sierra Nevada Ice Company offers the highest quality product at the most reasonable rates. Kindly accept our order for 10 tons of quality ice, or if you have not that much on hand, as much ice of the highest grade as you can supply us at this time, provided the amount is not less than 6 tons. Delivery to be arranged pending your positive response on or before 15 January 1913. Yours very sincerely, Arthur Benzinger, Jr., President. I didn't know there were different qualities of ice. Dmitri gave back the letter.
There are two, thin and thick.
His father glanced again at the typewritten words, then laid down the sheet and returned his glasses to his pocket.
I think we ought to check out this Rocky Mountain Company. No one I've asked has heard of it or Arthur Benzinger.
It's good stationery. Anyone can manage that. It doesn't mean they can pay for 8 tons of ice. What do you suppose they plan to do with it?
That's one of the things I want you to find out.
Me?
I want you to drive down and take a look at their operation and report back to me. I'll lend you the Ford. Don't wreck it. I'd send you on the train, but how would you get around once you got there? Los Angeles is a desert town strung out across 10 miles of dust.
Why me?
I can't spare the time, especially if it turns out to be a wild goose chase. Sooner or later, every crook and four-flusher in the country winds up in Southern California, moving pictures.
He stood and put on his coat.
Learning how to separate the charlatans from the solid customers will help you run this business. I have nothing against your wanting to write, Dmitri. But when times get hard, entertainment is the first thing people find they can live without. Meanwhile, they'll always need ice.
Chapter 2. Dmitri left his father supervising the stacking of the blocks in the ice house and rode back to Ingot in the back of the delivery wagon. He'd brought his typewriter and a dilapidated briefcase containing the manuscripts of some stories he was working on. He'd been told to pack his things and leave straight from the house in the morning. Yuri, the big Ukrainian, rode beside him with his long legs dangling over the open tailgate, smoking his short blob of charred pipe. He was the only employee under the age of 50 who had not been born in California as a descendant of the founders of the original Russian colony. The rumor persisted that he had caved in a hetman's skull with a bung starter during an argument in a tavern in Vladivostok when he was 17 and fled by way of Siberia to escape the wrath of the man's Cossack friends. Dmitri thought him capable of the act, but not the argument. He considered Yuri a big, powerful dog that didn't need to be belligerent in order to get its point across. They were nearly in town before he took his pipe out of his mouth to speak.
I hear you're going down to Los Angeles.
You must have heard it from my father. I haven't told anyone.
They say you can see whales from the beach.
I wouldn't know. I've never seen whales.
Sea lions, yes. Whales, no.
Did my father tell you to come along and hold my hand?
I wouldn't hold a man's hand unless he was going to hit me with it.
Yuri had a literal mind.
They say they're like islands that swim.
I'm 20 years old. I can find the place without a nanny. If I miss it, I'll just turn back when I get to Mexico.
I'd like to see those whales.
Your own drive so you can't spell me at the wheel. You don't know how to patch a tire or change the brake bands or stop the radiator from leaking. What good could you do me if I brought you along?
I've got a tent.
All his life, Dmitri had heard that the step-dwellers could read men's minds. He'd been wondering where he would stay nights. It was a 3-day drive down the coast, longer if one figured in the inevitable puncture and breakdown. Hotels, he had heard, were inconveniently located and much too expensive. The $300 his father had proposed to advance him had to be made to cover his expenses while in Los Angeles, as well as those incurred during the journey south. The prospect of camping out along the way nearly eliminated the latter. On the other hand, the cost of supporting two men far from home was exactly twice that of supporting one. And he had no illusions about the fact that his father had instructed Yuri to go along because he had no faith in his son's ability to carry off the mission on his own. "What will you live on when we get there?" he asked. Yuri looked around. Night was falling. The smoke from the chimneys of the houses on the edge of town said that most of Ingot was inside, sitting down to supper. He unfastened the top button of his heavy woolen shirt and pulled out the end of a necklace fashioned of gold coins the size of nickels.
Dmitri couldn't read the Cyrillic characters stamped on them, but he knew enough about Russian history to recognize the likeness of Tsar Alexander II.
"My mother's dowry," he said, slipping the necklace back inside the shirt. "It hung down to her knees when she married my father. There's a coin missing for every slump and a slump for every war."
"Are you sure you want to spend your mother's dowry on a trip to Los Angeles?"
"It was getting heavy anyway."
Whatever argument Dmitri might have introduced lost its opportunity as they slowed for a hill. With a Tartar's athletic grace, the big man sprang off the back of the wagon.
"Where are you going?"
"To dig out the tent. I'll be at your house at dawn."
He was already a disembodied voice in the shadows. The Pulski house was a Queen Anne, the largest in its neighborhood, with gables and turrets sufficient for a structure six times its size. It replaced the salt box Dmitri's parents had moved into shortly after their wedding, three rooms without electricity or plumbing that Dmitri's mother still spoke of with nostalgia. Andrei had demolished it, hired an architect from San Francisco, and begun construction on the new place the first year the company showed a profit. Bad weather had prolonged the project an additional 6 months, and between the extra cost and the panic of 93, the black figures disappeared from the ledgers, and Andrei had been forced to offer a partnership in the company to his brother-in-law, Paul, in return for funds to avoid bankruptcy. Dmitri's father and uncle barely spoke except to argue about how the firm should be run, and although the fact was never mentioned, it was no secret that Andrei loathed the house and blamed it for the loss of his autonomy. Dmitri kissed his mother, a tiny woman with black hair and eyes, and went up to pack his things. Her grave expression told him she knew of his father's decision. She had married Andrei by proxy in 1890 and had been his wife 2 years when she left Siberia and came to America to make his acquaintance. Her father had died in the salt mines for his friendship with a man who had been executed after the assassination of the second Alexander, and her mother had taught her always to be grateful to Andrei for having delivered her from poverty and shame. She was, by and large, silent. The door to Dmitri's turret room stood open. This was by his father's decree that he might summon the other members of the household without having to stir himself from the hearth in the parlor. Because the noise of the blick disturbed him, and because Dmitri required a sense of isolation to concentrate, he wrote very little at home. Only in the shack could he be prolific. His suitcase, brown leather with brass corners, still smelled new after 2 years. It was a graduation present, requested by him, but his youthful plans of world travel after the example of Jack London aboard the Snark had been shelved when he went to work at the company full time. On top of socks and underwear, he placed a stack of cotton shirts for the gentler climate down south, two pairs of flannel trousers, a wool pullover for the transition, and for entertainment, his copy of Burning Daylight. After tucking his shaving things into a corner, there was just room for the briefcase and a ream of paper. If his idol could produce 1,000 words a day, even on a round-the-world cruise, he had no excuse not to work, although he hoped it wouldn't come to his having to use a boulder for a desk. His father was on time for supper, as always. The three ate in silence, conversation having been banished from the table as harmful to digestion. Afterward, they sat in the parlor. Dmitri read The Captain of the Susan Drew, while his mother sewed buttons on shirts and his father went over the ledgers. Not a word was spoken until the 8-day clock on the narrow mantel struck 10. Andrei confirmed the time upon his pocket winder and looked at his son. "Early day tomorrow." Dmitri nodded and stood. "I had that Mexican fellow at the garage fill the Ford with water and gasoline, the cans as well. The Atlas is on the seat. Keep the ocean on your right, below Salinas, and you won't get lost. You have the letter with the address." It wasn't a question, but Dmitri affirmed he had Arthur Benzinger's letter. His father produced an envelope from the side pocket of his smoking jacket. "$300 should cover any emergency. I expect half of it back. Keep a record and save receipts. If it's a loss, we'll have a hard winter making it up." He accepted the envelope. He had never held that much cash at one time. The elder Pulski handled all the collections and payments personally. "Good nights," were said, and Dmitri went upstairs. The prospect of the trip excited him. He had never been that far from home and parents. As a writer, he was troubled by his lack of experience. At his age, Jack London had been an oyster pirate, sailed the northern seas, ridden the rods across the country, and begun preparations to prospect for gold in the Yukon. Dmitri had spent that time cutting ice and reading. The stories he wrote were products of imagination with liberal borrowings from London, Joseph Conrad, and Rudyard Kipling. They were set in places he had never been and described actions he had never seen. Even his account of the San Francisco earthquake had been inspired by descriptions he had read in The Call. He was in school in Ingot, memorizing his times table when the city shook apart. If there was still adventure to be had in 20th century California, he meant to take it in between here and the offices of the Rocky Mountain Moving Picture Association. On that thought, he dropped off, dreaming of earthquakes and pirates. He was up before dawn, but not ahead of his mother, who, when he sat down at the dining room table, placed before him a plate of eggs and sausages and a mug of scalding coffee. His father appeared, suited and collared for the office, as he was finishing. Dmitri rose to accept his lecture of paternal wisdom. Andre looked at his watch, returned it to his vest pocket, and said, "I will expect you back on the 12th. Use the telegraph if you run into trouble." Dmitri's mother had prepared sandwiches from last night's ham. She presented them to him in a paper sack along with a vacuum bottle filled with milk. He kissed her on the cheek, put on his Mackinaw and cap, and carried his suitcase, typewriter, and provisions outside. Yuri was seated on the running board of the black tin box Model T parked in front of the house. He wore his bearskin. A roll of faded green canvas lay across the rear bumper, secured to it with rope. The Ukrainian's breath smoked in the flinty dawn cold. No greetings were exchanged. The young man strapped his suitcase to the running board on the driver's side, found a place for the milk and sandwiches in the toolbox mounted behind it, and stood the blick on the floorboards against the seat. There was an anticlimax to his farewells when the crank failed to turn the motor over and he had to go back inside and heat a tea kettle. With steaming water in the radiator, the motor responded reluctantly. Another trip inside and a second dose of hot water were required before it coughed, bucked, and settled into the pukkata-pukkata of its delicate idle. The pair climbed in, Dmitri released the brake, engaged the clutch, and the odyssey began. With a 30-minute interruption 2 miles south of town, while Dmitri pulled the left rear wheel off the rim, patched up a fresh puncture from the vulcanizing kit in the toolbox, pumped up the tire, and bolted the wheel back into place. Yuri lit his pipe and watched. Past Chico, they drove out of the snow, although it could still be seen topping the coast range to the west and the Sierras to the east. They shrugged out of their coats. At noon, they were still 10 miles north of Yuba City, an hour behind schedule, but they pulled off the road to refill the tank beneath the seat from the 5-gallon can on the running board and to allow the overheated motor to cool. Dmitri and Yuri split up the ham sandwiches and passed the cup from the vacuum bottle back and forth, washing down the salty meat with milk. "Big state," Yuri said. "I didn't know the roads would be this bad. I was sure we broke an axle on that hole up by Los Molinos. When we get back, I'm going to write a thank you letter to Henry Ford." Dmitri replenished the water in the radiator, and they resumed their journey. Outside Sacramento, the brakes went out, and they rolled to a stop against a tree, bending the front bumper. Dmitri's father, who knew nothing about automobile mechanics and trusted too much to the people who did, had neglected to have the brake bands changed, and they had worn clean through. Dmitri crawled underneath, removed the canvas scraps, and put on new bands from the toolbox. They were always wearing out. In the course of a year, he had whittled down the time required to change them from 2 hours to 45 minutes, purely from practice. Still, the operation put them further behind schedule. The state capital made Ingot look like the wide spot in the road it was. The residential streets were lined with colonials and Queen Anne's, the smallest of them as large as the house Andrei Ivanovich Pulski had nearly bankrupted himself building. The business district alone was larger than Dmitri's hometown. Model T's, Oldsmobiles, and one elongated Thomas Flyer were parked on the main street beside brewers, drays, and saddle horses. A cardboard sign erected before the entrance to the Sacramento Theater advertised that a moving picture would be shown there that evening entitled The Squaw Man. They had hoped to make San Jose before nightfall, but as the sun was going down, the radiator boiled over and Dmitri sent Yuri into Stockton on foot to refill the water can. By the time he came back, dusk was settling. They pitched the tent on the roadside. The Ukrainian had brought a duffel containing tins of meat and oysters and assorted utensils. They gathered wood, built a small fire, and made oyster stew, which they ate from mismatched bowls with battered spoons. "Hard to believe we're eating outside with our coats unbuttoned," Dmitri said. "They're having a January thaw here." "No, I've heard it's like this all winter." "Where do they get their ice?" "From us." He tilted his bowl. "What's Stockton like?"
"I didn't see much of it. I don't think it's as big as Sacramento."
"Nothing's as big as Sacramento except San Francisco." Yuri put down his spoon and lifted his bowl to his lips to empty it.
"They got those moving pictures. I saw a sign."
"What's this one called?"
"I don't remember."
Dmitri set aside his bowl and rubbed his hands over the fire. "What time is it?"
"I don't have a watch. Early, I guess. 7, maybe."
"I'm not even a little bit sleepy, are you?" Yuri used his sleeve to wipe oyster stew from his beard.
"I can't sleep much more than 4 hours."
"I wonder what time they start showing those pictures."
7:30.
When Dmitri looked at him,
"I remember numbers."
"We can't leave the tent, can we?" The Ukrainian looked at it. It was patched in several places and spotted with mildew like white buckshot.
"Who'd steal it?"
Stockton was bigger than Ingot. But then, considered Dmitri in the light of his newfound worldliness, almost every place was. Beyond that, it was a miniature version of Sacramento, right down to the theater, a plain building with a shallow entryway decorated only by an old poster of Anna Held, corseted literally to within an inch of her life. Dmitri handed a quarter to a bald man in handlebars behind a counter and got back 2 tickets and 15 cents. He gave the tickets to a stout woman with her hair dyed black and pince-nez glasses on her nose, and she pulled back a curtain so he and Yuri could pass through. Now they were in a narrow auditorium lit by bowl fixtures with Ionic columns painted on either side of the proscenium. Most of the seats were occupied for the first showing of a feature called The Musketeers of Pig Alley. They passed a projector on a table bolted to the floor. Dmitri had seen one of the contraptions in the San Francisco Opera House, but this time he paused to study its two big reels, operated by a hand crank with a wooden handle, and the way the glistening strip of film traveled over rubber pulleys and between plates of glass on its way from one reel to the other, like spring runoff spilling down the uneven surface of Mount Shasta. The machine was built of pebbled black sheet metal with a cast iron base and probably weighed 50 pounds. They found 2 seats together halfway down the aisle, where they had an unobstructed view of a taut canvas screen erected behind the footlights. An upright piano stood against the wall to the left of the stage with a landscape painted on its front panel. Dmitri, craning his neck to see everything with a writer's eye, watched the stout woman waddle down the aisle and hoist herself onto the stool in front of the piano. She switched on a green-shaded lamp, arranged a sheaf of music on the tilt board, adjusted her pince-nez, and cracked her knuckles. The sound, like a string of firecrackers going off, sent a chuckle rippling through the audience. At that moment, the bald man came in and took up his station behind the projector. He flipped a switch, releasing a shaft of light from the lens that shot over the heads of the audience and splashed onto the screen. When he stepped over to the wall and pushed the button that extinguished the overhead fixtures, the bright screen dominated the room. Tobacco smoke, for the room reeked of cigars, curled in the powerful beam. The crank was engaged. As it turned, ratcheting gently...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.